Let me start going ahead on fatigue. We've been talking of human element. I mean, I've heard a lot of people in various sessions today saying fatigue, human element, etc. So let's put some thing to numbers over here. So let's start with what the problem is. Is there really a problem? Why are we making so much ado about it? Let's go further. What we've deduced to see, we've reached here. So what, as a club, we did, we have a lot of, as a club, we did a lot of analysis of various operations to see whether there is a problem, because if it isn't broken, you can't fix it. We started with our passenger claims, a passenger vessel incidents. So this is what we got. I'm not going to go through it, otherwise I'll run out of time. But as you can see, the human factor is a major thing. There are other things called inadequate maintenance, procedures, show management, etc. And one thing which everyone loves to blame is God. Yes, I know God created us all, but every surveyor likes to send an act of God. Bad weather, act of God. Anything, act of God. I'm sure they won't get a free passage to heaven when it's all being assessed. But when we break it down, we got to take out a lot of act of God, and only when it's really catastrophic can we attribute it to the Almighty. We did the navigational claims next. Interesting, equipment failure. After God, the next most blamed is equipment, because probably it can't talk back and argue. But everybody else likes to say, oh, the equipment conked off. But then you can see the other ones, the colorful ones, which, when it's brightly colored, it's always danger. When it's dull and drab, it's something that's quite all right. We learn that from the traffic lights. We cross the road every day. This is where we got on our causation. Equipment failure was 7. Improper handling, 29. Watch keeping, 32. Passage planning was 6%. Pilot error was 10%. Yes, they're humans as well. And weather monitoring was 16%. And here it is. Again, we did our oil tankers. We analyzed the incident claims. This is what we found. I think I've already explained what all these colorful bars mean. There again, 223 oil tanker claims, and it's not easy analyzing these claims because you have these so many long notes from your lawyers, and they go into pages and pages, and then when you start reading something meaningful, you've forgotten where you started from. So kind of, it's a difficult process, and about 223 claims takes around about 4 months to get it right. Here you are. Again. Mooring incidents, which is, I think, particular to all types of vessels. Total of 110 claims in 2017. This is where we got a nice colorful donut. Mooring equipment failure was 30%, but I would stop short of saying that even in this 30%, the mooring equipment failure, there will be a lot of fingerprints, if you go into it, on why it failed. Lack of inspection, lack of maintenance. So, I've just been very, very forgiving over here when I did this kind. This was probably one of the first set of statistics, so I said, let's not blame the guy so much. Inadequate supervision, communication failure, and there you are. Oh, there's more. Enclosed space entry, something which is so well regulated, everything's perfect. It's not really rocket science, but still, in 1 year, we had 15 claims in the analysis years, and we had 6 fatalities. Even one fatality is unacceptable. We go on board ships to work, we earn money, we go through hardships to come back so that we can spend it. Come back on 2 feet, not in a body bag. So even one fatality is looked at quite critically by us. And you can make out that 100% of these claims, again, would have the human element attributed to it, because there is very little to go wrong apart from that. Just to summarize it on what we've just done. So this is how we've got it. So who's being blamed? There you are. Again, where does the problem lie? Do we continue to blame human error? So in 1998, the ISM code, this was the answer to everything. This was a 12th commandment. Once you cut up all your trees, make them into checklists, put them into your files, there will be no more marine incidents. So that was it. Human error was in excess of 80% at that time. And wow, let's do something about it. 21 years down the line, what steps we've done actually shows it slightly worse off. So kind of shows something like this, that we've got it right in the penalty spot. And it sums it up. So this is what it appears to me. I could be wrong. You may have a different viewpoint. Are we on the right track? Human error? Yep. Blame culture? Human element approach. You may think I'm playing with words, but this is how we should be thinking. This is what the industry is now thinking. Let's find out why and not who is at fault. There's a lot of training. You know, we've got an overkill of training. You know, everything needs a training course. You want to sneeze on board, you've got a training course. You'll probably have to clock in hours. You've probably got a checklist to take a dump. It's really a lot of paperwork on board. Everything is processed. And, you know, do we really think a person going on board is ignorant or not aware? He's probably had more training courses and hours preparing to go on his first ship than what we had in our entire sailing career. You know, so that's how much well he is. It's not ignorance, it's not a lack of knowledge. He is well aware. He's got enough tools. So again, human error, or are we missing a trick here? So let's talk of fatigue, because I think a lot of it comes down from my next slide. One way of thinking, and I don't have a crystal ball here. I know Appa's going to ask us later with a crystal ball. But no, if I had a crystal ball, I'd be solving the world's problems right now. But again, lack of concentration, not focused crew, because it's all there, the tools are there. And another major contributing factor, fatigue. And we like to use the term fatigue rather loosely. Internet on board. Is it a pro or con? Everyone would say, yeah, internet. We could debate on this. I mean, it's another topic altogether. But there are pros and cons. We say at one time, health and well-being, stay in touch with the family, give us internet. But then they finish their, say, 16 hours of watch, and then they go back to their rooms. So you're probably wearing your four stripes as a master. You've done your 16 hours, and then you go back to your room. Then what happens is you take out your captain's hat, and what do you wear? You wear your husband cap, or maybe your parental cap, and then you've got Facebook, you've got this thing. You have your wife telling you that the neighbor's dog died. The neighbor's dog died. Everything happened. This one's got a toothache, blah, blah, blah. So instead of getting rest, you're actually trying to solve the problems at home, which really isn't exactly making most use of your rest hours. How do we currently measure fatigue? You know, and hours of rest, when you go on board, to check your rest hours. Everybody has to maintain your hours of work, hours of rest. Trust me, gentlemen, that's the most perfect document you'll find on board. Immaculately timed. You cannot find a flaw in that. I mean, I'm yet to see anybody go on board and find out, oh, there was a mistake with the rest hours. Seriously, never. It's absolutely perfect. We know that there's a person assigned at the end of the month around the 26th. Here's the bell book. Here are the rest hours, you know, and let's have it perfectly synced over there. Nobody, and we all know it doesn't work. You know, people are fatigued. Why are they fatigued? Are they doing enough? It really is something we are missing. Again, how are our current methods of measuring fatigue? Really advanced. I mean, we've had some very nice digitalized pictures and all that. So what the club is doing, sorry, this is not a marketing thing, but what we're doing is now, we're actually trying to measure fatigue, like how you measure alcohol, etc., from the system. So we're trialing it with a company called SAFR, which is Sleep and Fatigue Research. So what happens is we're trialing it with two members where they are wearing Fitbits. Due to GDP restrictions, we can't put the entire data, but we can actually take their sleep patterns and, you know, these kind of things. So when they are off, we can actually find out whether they are resting. This company actually has software with the proper algorithms, etc., and they put it on with, you know, your age, your nationality, a lot of other criteria, and they actually find out whether you're rested or not, whether you're going in the right direction or whether the alarm bells are ringing. So I can imagine this is going to give rise to more questions. Suppose you go on watch and your master says you're not rested. What are you going to do? Call somebody else? But you have only a handful of people on board anymore. So is this giving rise to more problems? We have to see how to take it further. But this would be very useful by operators to determine whether manning levels on board are sufficient to cope with the current operations. Because now the ISM code puts it back on the operator. This is the minimum manning certificate. Everybody fails to see the minimum in the minimum manning certificate. It is the maximum manning. You know, why would you go? But now it's come back on, the onus has come back on the operators that they have to assess their operations and make sure they have enough people on board. This could be an effective tool. We conducted something else with a bridge alarm surveys, and we stumbled upon something called alarm fatigue. Don't get alarmed about it, but the main thing is we teamed up with the Department of Psychology at Royal Holloway, and we circulated questionnaires on board to find out whether what's contributing to the navigational incidents as such. And we found out that alarm fatigue was something new we were getting to be made aware of. A lot of it because the alarms were all sounding the same. I mean, anytime you go on a bridge, you'll just hear about 5-6 alarms sounding the same. And that's normal. I mean, you go on a bridge with no alarm sounding, you would think probably it's an inoperational vessel. So you find a lot of alarms going. They couldn't find out the difference with alarms, but basically the more important alarms weren't louder or not like, you know, blow it out of you. The design of the bridge, these were problems over there. And this was something which actually made the seafarer switch off, because when you get an alarm, 9 cases out of 10, it's fake. You know, it's just false alarm. Let's not go in. Because it all sounds the same. So something is actually ringing where you've got a collision error. And you would think it's just your GPS being kinky. And that's it. I mean, this was what we got back in the feedback. So this is something we are actually putting up to the IMO. There's one session which has already been presented to them, there's something needs to be done where we can have different levels of alarm, etc. And this is fatigue in some way, not sleep-related fatigue, but it's just a frustration which we are trying to get it mended. I've been talking really fast, I know. I don't even think so. Like he said, I really don't have a joke to share. I should have prepared. But right now, we are at the tip of the iceberg. And I think we need to rethink our ways of how we measure fatigue rather than that perfect document where nothing is out of place. So that's it from me. Oh, gosh. Oh, 30 seconds, not too bad. Thank you, everyone, for staying awake. Thank you.